gamble is like life, you know? It's the grand metaphor of life.
5:36 a.m. and floor staff have just called casino security. A tourist has been playing the same roulette wheel all night. At first, they thought he was an addict, but now they think it's far worse because he appears to be in profit. And in the last hour, he's doubled his stakes. Last night, a young woman was doing something similar.
In half an hour, you have all the things that happen in life. All the struggle, all the victories, the catastrophe, everything.
They don't know what's going on because at the time, nobody thinks it's possible. Little do they know, they're about to get a massive shock. This is the story of a poor family that beat Vegas roulette. It's early in the 90s and a small-time music producer, radio host and film director is at a pivotal point in his life. For many years, he's worked extremely hard. The money isn't great and the hours are long. In truth, he's had enough. He wants to get out of the business. He wants a better life for his family. He wants to get rich. This is where his recent obsession comes in, roulette. After an exceptionally hard week, he's there again. In the casino Grand Madrid, stood next to his favourite roulette wheel. 16. It's the fourth time it's come up. He vaguely remembers it coming up last week too. He ponders for a moment. Is it really a coincidence? He wants to find out and he's desperate to make money, so he starts to track the amount of times it comes up. In doing so, he realises that 24, just two spaces away from his mark, is also a regular result. He sits there for hours. It's too good to be true. By the end of the evening, he's convinced there's a huge opportunity here. He just has to get to the bottom of it. But how? To crack the code, Gonzalo needs to gather data for his theory. Initially, he thinks 3,000 spins will be enough. So after he finishes work for the following fortnight, he sits in the casino Grand Madrid writing down numbers. At 5 hours a night, it's intense stuff. To lighten the load, he acquires help from his children, Ivan and Vanessa. Later, after reviewing the data, Gonzalo's hunch appears to be right. The roulette wheel is biased. For context, roulette biases can appear for a multitude of reasons. If a wheel sees a lot of action, the central rotor starts to warp and wobble. If the wheel is tilted, the roulette table is uneven, or if the wheel's track is significantly worn from excessive play. All of these things can cause certain numbers to come up more frequently. Typically, one or two numbers are affected on almost every roulette wheel. As you might expect, nothing in life is completely random. And now, Gonzalo plans to make the most of it. Thoughts of financial freedom, fast cars, a flashy lifestyle, and hanging out in Vegas all flash through his mind. It's the get-rich-quick scheme he's always dreamt of. Quickly, he recruits more family members to record roulette data. Now, they're tracking individual data for all of the roulette wheels in the casino Grand Madrid. They discover that different wheels produce different biases. Not only do some favour certain numbers, but there are numbers that rarely come up. These are the numbers to avoid. If he assigns each wheel a number with unique values, he believes that he can create an effective way to beat the house. Creating a score system like this quite literally allows him to value each individual wheel. He knows they must play harder and stake bigger on the numbers with the highest expected outcome. It's basic math. But the best part? It's not cheating. Just like card counting, he's being smart and playing within the rules. However, there's a problem. The casino isn't going to like this one bit. Gonzalo isn't fazed though, he isn't doing anything wrong, and being a hard worker that has paid his taxes all his life, he believes in the system. He just needs more data to be absolutely sure of his edge. In gambling, short-term variance often hides the bigger picture. Like all great gambling strategies, Gonzalo needs a very large sample of results to truly measure his average advantage accurately. So this time, he deploys the entire family. Their aim? To document and collect over 30,000 results. For 5 or 6 hours a night, six of the Paleo family sit by different roulette tables in the casino. They're skeptical and they think he's crazy. But big money promises do the trick. After two whole weeks, they've done it. The data set is complete. Gonzalo's daughter is concerned though. She's skeptical of the casino's reaction. Already, she suspects that the casino staff are watching them. And his nephews agree, but Gonzalo puts it down to their age and forges on. After all, his strategy is going to make them millionaires. After sifting through the data, he now knows exactly which roulette tables, wheels, and numbers are best to bet on. He's not messing around. He'll run this operation like a business. With five of the family members placing bets simultaneously, he sets some ground rules. 1. Don't tell anybody. their operation must remain 100% secret. 2. No risk taking, no wasting money, and no tips. This is business, not a leisure visit. And 3, we only play roulette, and only at Bias Wills, nowhere else. With his family hitting the house, he doesn't want any mistakes. Discipline is paramount because money is scarce. Quite literally, he can't afford to mess this up. To finance his secret plan, he's just sold his biggest asset, all of the rights to one of his documentaries, previously considered to be his best work. In today's money, it puts the equivalent of $4,700 in the pot. Hopefully, this will be enough to see him through a bad run of short-term variance. It's a long shot in itself, so the team will start with small bets, just to be safe. As frustrating as this is, it's very wise. If they lose, it hurts less, and if they win, they won't draw much attention. So finally, after a lot of hard work, armed with their fine-tuned data, and a year after Gonzalo's initial experience, they're in a position to play ball and win. Entering Madrid's Premier Casino individually, Gonzalo and his family believe they have a 6% advantage, more than double the house edge. In theory, they should be able to win money from the casino at twice the speed it's usually lost. European roulette gives the house a 2.7% edge over the player because there's only one green number on the wheel, the number 0. Betting rules are simple. Players can bet on an exact number where the payout is 35-1, or they can bet a red or black number will come up at even odds. The players aren't interested in betting red or black. They're here for the bias alone. It means that most of the time they bet, they'll lose. However, because of the bias, the 35-1 wins they hit will drastically outweigh the losses. Except things haven't started well. For the first 2 hours, the numbers they've been betting on don't connect. Spin after spin, loss after loss, their already small bankroll is disappearing fast. A stressed out Gonzalo knows he needs to be patient. And then probability bites back, dealing the team several high stakes wins in a row. Despite the early losses, their first serious night of roulette is a profitable one. But Gonzalo has no intention of leaving it there. They go back every night that week, gradually increasing their bets each time. The more they win, the more they stake. Later, it would be reported that they nearly quadrupled their money in that first month of play. And in the second month, their bottom line jumped more than 10 times to a whopping $100,000. For context, that's the equivalent of $227,000 today. Very quickly, it became a large-scale operation. 6 Paleo family members are now at different roulette wheels inside the Casino Gran Madrid for 6 nights a week. The more they play, the more they win, and the bigger their bankroll gets, so the more they can stake. Varying results are no longer a problem. They can absorb losing runs of bad luck if needed. But ironically, with multiple players at multiple wheels, the sample of bets is increased, meaning that the chance of a losing streak is drastically reduced. For around half a year, the family are taking today's equivalent of $25,000 per month. To them, it's life-changing. Designer watches, cars, and jewellery are starting to appear. But once more, there's an issue. The casino croupiers now know them very well. They recognise them as consistent winners who never show emotion or leave a tip. Their behaviour makes them stand out for the crowd. I mean, who doesn't celebrate a winner? In Spain, winners who experience good fortune are expected to tip. Gonzalo's team complain it's drawing unnecessary attention towards them. But he won't have it. This is business, not keeping the casino staff happy. No tips. At the tables, it creates an awkward tension. Winning such large sums of money on a daily basis is frustrating for the low-paid croupiers. It's seen as incredibly greedy. And eventually, word of the greedy players who keep winning at the roulette reaches management. This is where the real problems start, because they now know why casino profits are lower than usual. Casino security are made aware. And now, Gonzalo and his children are thrust into the spotlight. The croupiers detest them. Management are trying to work out their advantage, and security staff are following them around. They've even been tracked outside of the casino. Worse still, Gonzalo's nephew's expensive habits are drawing attention like a red flag for all who are watching. The Casino Gran Madrid is down $500,000 to the Paleos. They realise quite how serious this is getting when one of the casino staff makes an unsettling comment about his former job. Clearly, it's an attempt to intimidate them. But it doesn't work. Sensing their time's limited, the team kick on and up the stakes. It infuriates management, so Casino starts messing with the game. When a croupier spots one of the team, they spin up the ball harder than before. It's a massive own goal on the casino's behalf. Speeding up the ball actually helps the team's strike rate. These fools are accidentally smoothing out results and reducing short-term variance for Gonzalo and his team. Next, the casino changed their strategy. Overnight, they switched the roulette wheels between the tables. Although this makes it clear, once again, they haven't got a clue about Gonzalo's strategy. Ever since they began recording data, the team identified each wheel via unique marks that they carry. Switching the wheels doesn't make a difference. It just means that they play different numbers at different tables now. However, the casino are now tracking which numbers they bet to. Seeing that their bets follow the wheels is a direct tip-off for the casino. The strategy is all about which wheel they're playing. Either way, casino bosses have had enough. The family is banned. If Gonzalo or any of his team are seen in the casino, the instruction is to throw him out. Frustrated, Gonzalo turns to the government's regulatory commission for intervention, and the judge rules in his favour. While the court advocates for their participation, the casino's verbal agreement proves empty. They continue to expel them without repercussions from the court. In Madrid, the casino operates under the watch of the gaming police, who frequent it nightly and dine there, forging friendships with the casino management, essentially safeguarding their interests. Ultimately, the casino has got away with it, yet Gonzalo is dismayed by the commission's inaction towards those who blatantly disregard its directives. He's been naive at 45 years old. He believes the governing system is fair and open. So far, he's won around $1 million. Adjusted for inflation, that's about 2.2 now. Defiantly, Gonzalo enters the casino and begins to play. Next, security arrive. He argues back, citing the commission's ruling in his defense. This time, things get a little bit more physical. Gonzalo is ejected from the casino's front door. It appears that they couldn't care less. But the confrontational Spaniard isn't gonna quit. He marches into the local government office once more and submits a further appeal. Success. Once more, they rule that he and his family should be able to play roulette in the casino. However, when he arrives, he's horrified to see that the casino has totally changed the game. New roulette wheels, new tables, and in different positions. They've deliberately messed with the original setup. You have to wonder, who's the real cheat here? Stressed out and mildly depressed, Gonzalo acknowledges it's time to move on. After all, there's still big money to be made in Europe, London, and even Vegas. A bias wheel is a bias wheel, wherever you are in the world. First, they venture further into Europe, where they take Amsterdam's casino for several hundred thousand. It's short-lived though, as many of the European casinos communicate with one another. Once they catch on and communicate with Madrid, the game is up. They have the magic formula, but nowhere to use it. Roulette wheels are now being changed and renewed on a regular basis. Plus, some of the casinos are demanding ID before you play. It's a real problem for the players as it marks their cards even quicker. So it's time to make the plunge and make their boldest move yet. Once more, Gonzalo pulls together a smaller but stealthy team. This time, they're making the 8,900-mile trip to Sin City for 3 months. Except there's a twist. American roulette is slightly different in that the house edge is bigger and harder to beat. Vegas roulette wheels have more than one green number. This seemingly small detail means that the house edge is 5.26% over players. It means that Gonzalo and his family must only play the most biased wheels if they're to win. Previously, their advantage over European roulette was around 6%, so it's not impossible, but it will be more difficult. And of course, it's not the only problem. They need to beat Vegas surveillance too. In Vegas, their security systems are better and much bigger. However, they've got experience on their side this time, so they approach things differently. Firstly, tipping will be allowed. Second, they'll keep the stakes modest, only increasing them towards the end of their trip. And thirdly, as they identify bias wheels, they'll also make notes about casino staff. The plan is to blend in with all the other tourists without being noticed. To do this, they map out all of the shift patterns for various casino staff. Whilst hitting a bias wheel, they will rotate who's playing so that the croupier doesn't realise the same person playing all the time. Plus, they'll disguise their accents to try and blend in. The whole scheme is elaborately organized to avoid being noticed. Plus, they will enter and leave the casino individually to avoid being linked. It's tougher than before, but they soon find their stride. Several months into the visit, they've banked more than six figures. With extremely biased Wills, he wants to crank up the numbers before they leave. The team have been playing deep into the small hours, spin after spin. He's betting maximum stakes now, despite feeling a little bit worn out. 19. Typical, he's hit 19 several times now and he's starting to feel frustrated. But being how Gonzalo is, like a dog with a bone, he just can't stop. 19 again. Suddenly, his legs turn to jelly. He doesn't know what's going on. Before he even realizes it, he bounces off the table, collapsing on the floor. Gonzalo, shouts his daughter as several family members run over. They've just blown their cover. Now, the casino staff know they're together. But what's happened? The high stakes pressure of a night-long binge in the casino has finally caught up with him. The family fears he's had a heart attack, although, fortunately, it later transpires that it was just exhaustion and stress. After several years of beating the house and more than $1.5 million in profit, he's forced into his worst nightmare, giving up roulette. After all, there's no point being the richest man in the graveyard, right?